Better Listen is proud to present Finite and Infinite Games with James Carse.
I'm going to ask you first, sort of an embarrassing question, I hope you don't mind, but how many of you have read the book? That's embarrassing to me, actually. I mean, I thought there'd be more of you out there. Well, it's okay. The reason I wanted to ask you that question is that it will help determine how I'm going to sort of design the evening, whether I should really lecture out of the book or lecture about the book. And I can see what I'll do is lecture out of the book. What I'd like to do is to set out some of what I think are its more discussable, that is to say, more questionable elements. Sort of lay those out as well as I can, briefly, though, and then give you a chance to ask questions. I hope you have plenty of questions. Even if you haven't read the book, I hope some of the material that I'll discuss will give rise to questions. We're kind of open-ended here. Consistent with the whole idea of the center, so that we don't have to close at some certain time. But I don't like to lecture a long period of time. So, by the way, while I'm lecturing, too, if you have a question, raise your hand. There are a couple old students here, I notice, and I'm sure they won't hesitate at all to do that if they have questions. They were doing it plenty when they were undergraduates. I should tell you first how the idea of the book came to me, because I think it helps put the book in perspective. It makes it a more modest enterprise than it seems to be with, you know, when you get it all printed up in a fancy cover and so on. Maybe 15 years ago, I was, it was a certain Saturday morning. Now, like some of you, no doubt, I've raised children in the city. Three kids are now grown up. But at that time, they were all young, and they were at that age when children are something of a problem, particularly on Saturday mornings. You really don't know quite what to do with, that's the worst time of the week, actually, Saturday mornings. Because what usually happens is that by Saturday morning, you yourself have generated all kinds of projects that you weren't able to get done during the week, and you've saved them for Saturday morning. And suddenly you wake up Saturday morning, the kids are saying, you know, what are we going to do today? And, you know, we're bored, and this place stinks, and, you know, and... And so you try to put them on the street, and the weather's a little bad, and whatever. So Saturday mornings tend to be family conflict times. At least they were in our family. Now, I had several wonderful solutions for this as a rule. I mean, sometimes if they were really bad, the best solution I had for that Saturday morning conflict was to take the kids up to the Metropolitan Museum into the mummy room, you know, to the Egyptian exhibit. They loved that. And that would really silence them and set them into important thought right away. The morning I recall, though, started, I should say, a little bit ominously. We had breakfast and raced through breakfast sort of characteristically, very early probably. And then I noticed after an hour or so that there was absolutely no sound at all from the children's room, really, really nothing. Well, I thought it was a little bit suspicious, but because there was no sound, it was okay with me. I mean, I just kept doing whatever I was doing. And another hour went by, and still really no sounds. Occasionally, a child would run out from their bedroom, which was back at the end of a long hallway, appear in the kitchen briefly, grab something out of one of the big kitchen drawers and head back to the room. But I was so absorbed in whatever I was doing that I wasn't paying attention to this much. And then finally, around lunchtime, I decided that it was time for them to, you know, get out of there and have something to eat. I did up a few grilled cheeses, which they love, and I called back to them to come eat lunch. But I've got these great grilled cheeses ready to go, and so on, and no response. And so I called again in a sort of more fatherly, authoritative tone, and still no response. So finally, I found myself headed back to the room and ready to make a grand theatrical appearance. So I grabbed hold of the door handle and pushed on the door, and somehow the door didn't quite open. It opened a little bit, but there was some kind of a funny obstruction to it, and the lights were off in the room. And I finally got my head in the door and looked around, and I saw a perfectly remarkable thing. The whole room, it was a fairly large bedroom. It had, they had bunk beds in it, and a couple dressers. Just an ordinary, messy kid's room, really. But the whole room was filled, was from one end to the other, with string. They had tied string to everything you can imagine in that room. And then they tied string to the string. And then they had passageways through the string, and so it was really quite an elaborate setup that they had in there. Now what I have to tell you though is that when I was looking in the door at these kids, I heard one of them say, "Hey Bob." Now my kid's name is not Bob, but Bob is one of the nicknames that developed in our family from somewhere back. It really means Bad Arm Bob. Bad Arm Bob. And the other nickname that my other son went by was the Downhill Flash. So I heard this boy say, "Hey Bob." "Yeah, Flash." And Bob said to Flash, "It's heavy weed." That's me. I really, honestly, I don't know where that name came from. I'm totally innocent about that. But what I realized is that I knew instinctively, as soon as I heard these names, as soon as I saw what was going on, is that they had put themselves in a totally different mode of behaving, of acting with each other. Now, normally what would happen when they started to play with each other is they'd set up some kind of a game, a board game, or they had this big, since the room was big enough, they actually put a, I got them one time, a ping pong table to put in the room, and it pretty much filled the room, but it was still, they still got it in the room. And I remember one day I went in there, and they were facing each other, about ready to start the ping pong game, and they were standing at either end of the table with their hands over some kind of a salute or some sort of a pledge of allegiance, of course, which they didn't know. I mean, but they were mumbling something like it was a pledge of allegiance. And written in chalk on either end of the ping pong table were the words Notre Dame on one side, and USA on the other. but what usually happened when they played games like that is that they would play the game according to very, very fixed rules, and no matter who won, everyone was unhappy. The loser would beat up the winner, and then the winner would beat up the loser, and they'd set up another game, and there was no fun. They had a bigger fight, after. But this was really a different mode this particular morning in this game. I didn't think of it as a game, actually. I thought of it, I just was happy that they were out of my hair, basically. So when I understood that I was heavy weed and I wasn't dad, that I was somehow part of the game structure, the play structure, I found myself really nicely, beautifully tempted, invited into joining it and not confronting it. I went back there to confront it. And suddenly when I heard someone say, "Hey, it's heavy weed," it sounded like fun. It sounded like it was open to me. So we ended up running string, naturally, all the way back down the hallway and into the kitchen. I'll tell you, if you've ever eaten a grilled cheese from a string, it's an experience you could do without, actually, to tell you the truth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.